class and you're thinking of taking 164B, doesn't mean that you have to sign up. The papers, of course, is what you're mainly concerned with now. Just on the technical side, if I could ask for a couple of things that make them a little bit more legible. Probably the most important one is be sure to put in page numbers. I know how it is the last minute you're frantically taking care of it and the last kind of thing that you want to be thinking about, but if you don't put in page numbers, it does make things more difficult for us in various ways. And it makes them more readable if you don't full justify them. You know what I mean? Just left justify them with ragged right. There's three little icons at the top of the horrible Microsoft Word bar up there. Do the left-hand one. It just makes them a little bit easier to read, and you have to read a lot of them, so that would be helpful. As far as references are concerned, you should know what to reference and how. The explicit attribution of fact that you've gotten somewhere, you know, you say, obviously, direct quotes or historical facts that you've gotten from some source, they need to be referenced. And any consistent, rational way of referencing them is fine. By rational, I mean, let's suppose you use the same book 35 times. You don't have to say each time, "Search for Nonviolent Future" by Michael A. Nagler, Inner Ocean Publishing, 2002, etc. Say, "Nagler opposite," or something like that. If it has Latin, it's bound to be rational. And more on the content side, what we've been seeing, and people have been bringing us paragraphs and stuff to look at so far, is a tendency to have a lot of unsupported belief statements, like just generalizations about nonviolence, most of which you know perfectly well I'm going to agree with. But remember, you're not writing this paper for me. The exercise is for you, and you're writing it for an intelligent, skeptical person. I'd say, I hope you won't find this to be stereotypical, but I often say, think of a friend of yours who is an engineering student, or a chem major, or somebody who's not used to thinking about how you think through social, political things.
Does that mean if we're talking about another movement, or comparing it to Gandhi's movement, or something, that we have to really go into explicit detail about the nonviolent principles we're talking about? We can't assume that they are.
Yeah, I think you can, as far as giving us historical background is concerned, I think you don't have to do too much, because that would just take up a lot of our time. And your point is not to put a lot of historical facts into the paper, but to analyze them and use them to back up your hypothesis and answer your question. So I think you can assume that we know, roughly speaking, who the Kudai Kidnikars were. If it's a movement that we haven't discussed in class, then go into it in greater detail. So that will be, it'll be a little bit inconsistent. As far as the rhetoric is concerned, you're going to write for a non-PAX major. But as far as using historical documentation is concerned, there's no need to rehash things that we're already familiar with. I hope that that will make sense.
Are the readers going to have Arkansas this week?
Well, let's ask them. What do you think?
I had them yesterday,
but maybe email or something.
Do you guys have
our
email addresses, or do you want us to do that?
I still have mine Thursday.
Several ways that you can get access to, notice I do not turn access into a group, being a former humanities person, there are several ways that you can get access to the collected works of Mahatma Gandhi, which have now been put on online. And probably the easiest way is www.gandhiserve.org, where if you have the right version of Adobe, you should be able to search. So, like for example, someone was talking to me this morning about heart unity, and you want to know more about what Gandhi said about it. If you just go to that website, go to Collected Works of Mahatma Gandhi, maybe it's just one or two steps, and then if you've got the right search technique, you just put in heart unity, and you'll get a complete spill out of all the places where Gandhi used that phrase. In case of heart unity, you'll probably have too much to deal with. But if you have a direct quote from Gandhi, you know enough of the language, and you can find it on Gandhi Serve, then you can use that as your reference. Okay. Oh, yeah, question.
Are we going to be able to like, get our papers back?
Or? You'll definitely be able to get them back. The question is when. I think if you get them, if the papers that are in on time, which is Thursday, and I hope that'll be most of them, if not all, I think we should be able to get most of them back by the early final, and certainly, if not then, by the formal official final, which is on that.
Thursday.
Yeah. Julia?
How many IDs did you have on the final?
How many IDs? We haven't totally decided yet. Probably a little bit more than was on the midterm, not a whole lot more. I hope that's not carpal tunnel.
It is.
Not a good time to come back. Okay. If there are no other immediate technical questions, here's our practice passage for today. On Thursday, I'll bring in a longer one. I thought I would just bring in a snappy one. Famous quote, it's originally attributed to Al Capone. You all know who Al Capone is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it was shadowed by our Secretary of Defense, Rumsfeld. And I've actually noticed that the present administration tends to imitate the rhetoric and statements of notorious criminals. I thought maybe you'd make a study of this, but I have better things to do. But it's an interesting observation that I'll just leave there. But I don't want to comment on that part of it. But there's the quotation. Now, suppose you got that in Roman numeral 2. Actually, what you'll get is a little bit longer just to give you more to work on. But suppose you had that quotation and I just said something like, what do you want to say about this? Comment, analyze, take apart, resist, reject, prove, whatever. Where would you start? Divya?
I'd say something about what power he's assuming that he's going to be using.
Uh-huh.
Threat power instead of either exchange power or integrated power.
Yes. So tell us exactly. Go ahead, Maya. They're not actually tall. Stand tall. Tell us exactly what part is threat power and what part is another kind of power.
So, you will get a lot more than the kind word added gun.
Okay.
So, you assume that you need to enforce yourself with some kind of a threat.
Okay.
Carrying a gun.
Okay.
Versus just the kind word alone, like the integrated power.
Right. I think more integrative power. Okay, so that's a very good start. And as a matter of fact, it's interesting, I had thought of that. So let's say that kind word is an example of integrative power. You could just give a quickie definition of what that is. A gun is a classic example of threat power. Snappy example of what that is. You drop it, the word can't folding, so everybody knows that you're totally up to speed. And what else would we want to say about this? Yeah.
They look at coercion as a powerful tool in their arsenal to
mm-hmm.
back people.
You know, that's the gun part, the threat power part, right? Coercion versus what? Coercion versus what? find it very difficult to exit from the non-violent paradigm. It's a point three. So there's one other quite important thing to get out of this, Julia.
It's something to do with glamorizing or stylizing violence instead of looking at it for what it is.
Well, I think these are different versions of what we've said already, and they're all true. That this is a person who clearly believes there's one CEO here. This is a person who clearly believes. I'd have to say this is a very cynical remark by a very cynical, hard-bitten person. This is like a John Bolton or somebody like that. And this person is saying that integrated power by itself doesn't work. You know, a couple of years ago, we had Air Force officer come and talk to this class, and he said, I'm glad that you people want to go out and do that stuff, but when you're facing a difficult opponent, would you please do me a favor, have a rifle squad behind you when you're going and doing these demonstrations? And I turned to the students and said, okay, who wants to start? And somebody whose whole family was Air Force, actually, said, no, we believe nonviolence is its own kind of power. And then he added something else, which is what I'm really fishing for. There's one other thing we haven't said about this statement yet. Yeah?
I don't know that it's what you're looking for, but this is definitely an example of strategic nonviolence versus a more principled nonviolence.
Yes, that's true, although it was not what I was looking for. Yeah?
Sort of the idea of nonviolence plus violence.
Yes.
Violence.
Yes. We haven't spoken about it very much, but I did mention Nadler's law, a rather ridiculous formulation, B plus NB equals B. So this is a clear violation of Nadler's law. And of course, the tragedy is that if a person went out there and said, you know, look, I like you, but I need your wallet, and if it led to some kind of bad result, the person would then say, see, nonviolence doesn't. In order to really see nonviolence at work, it has to emerge from the background and figure out the work. Okay? So I was going to just briefly go. Yeah, John?
You want that announcement about, you needed that announcement about the
fire? Yes, thank you.
122 Wheeler.
Okay.
On 9 to 12 on
Monday. Yeah. 9 a.m. to noon on Monday in 122 Wheeler. I think that's where we have our meditation class. That's terrific. That means we have all those vibes left over. It's a huge free lunch. That's great. In fact, we're probably going to have to take 5 points off your grade because it wouldn't be fair. So other people are taking the final in a non-meditation classroom. They wouldn't have that lift. Okay. I was just kidding. Yeah. Yeah, the other final will be as it was always scheduled to be.
One more question about the final. If we said that we want to take the final early, but then find that we don't have enough time to study before Monday, can we just go ahead and take it on Friday?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. It doesn't matter. We're not going to. It's just if nobody shows up, we'll be very sad. You really need this kind of timing to get your grades in on time.
Cool.
Okay. So what I'd like us to think about is the nonviolent worldview and breaking it down into parts. And the first part that I want to talk about is vision. How, when you've got principled nonviolence, you know, like I got religion, when you got it, how do you see the world, or what do you have to have seen about the world in order to move into this position? And I see this as very much a spectrum ranging from some kind of, hang on a second, connectedness. All the way. Premonitions. supposition or some kind of hint that things are more interconnected than they look, such that if you are unkind to somebody, that unkindness is going to have repercussions elsewhere, and it might eventually work its way around to you. But that can intensify all the way up to this great mystical vision that everything is one. You know, a famous Quaker mystic, John Woolman, on his deathbed in Britain, in London, he said, "I see the entire humanity as one yellow mass of suffering." The important thing being that he saw us all as one mass. And this contrasts with the way a not nonviolent person sees the world. Hardly want to even call it a vision, but if you accept the material reality and the appearance of the world, the phenomenal world as it appears to us, where we all look separate, then you're going to have a hard time really grasping and using nonviolence effectively. Okay, so that's so much for the vision. Then another characteristic difference is the way you frame relationships. And as somebody just said, if you have this kind of frame, to get more is your purpose, then you are living in what Ivan Illich called the paradigm of scarcity. And you're going to tend to try to build an economy of wants and acquisition in that kind of paradigm. But a nonviolent person does not frame relationships competitively. It does tend not to think of the world as a competition for scarce resources. And most importantly, when it comes to conflict, as we saw in my other model last week, you frame them as learning experiences, and most importantly, as win-win opportunities. In fact, one way to define nonviolence as a kind of energy or force, if I could borrow a term from the Graduate Theological Union, nonviolence is a kind of positive energy which can act to heal brokenness. Brokenness is a term that theologians have come up with. It's very handy, which describes, I guess we could also call it alienation, the sense that we are cut off from one another. In the famous words of Woody Allen, we are at two with nature, and we are at two with one another, and wherever we see difference, that can tend to become a cleavage plane, and we can get into radical separateness and think that in order for me to be happy, you have to be unhappy. And eventually we can go all the way and say that my happiness consists in your unhappiness, and then it's finished. Finito la musica, as they say. But we frame conflicts and relationships differently. We tend to look at ways of reintegrating, and so therefore our goal, well, let me put in goals here just as well. Try this language, just fitting that category there. Our goals for the outcome of a conflict include, sorry. This is such a sort of a thought experiment that we're doing to possibly end up on the Meta Center's website. Our goals for the outcome of a conflict include, but are not limited to, the eradication of an injustice that caused it. Reconciliation with the opponent becomes, if anything, more important because we are more aware of long-term growth and not obsessively concerned with short-term success. And then, the next category that's useful to think of, so I'm going to put down here reconciliation. In let me throw it over to you and see what we can come up with together. And we'll wrap it up, and I'll just open it wide for any questions or ideas or anything. But first, what do you think if, like, a Gandhi or a King or somebody was gone along with them? Shannon, what do you think?
I was just going to say, I think a fundamental part of all this is that you believe that humans are capable of being peaceful, nonviolent, and open.
Very, very true. And that, of course, would mean that the present criminal justice system is utterly misconceived. That anybody is, in theory, capable of being awakened. Let's put it that way, redemption. So therefore, since it's possible to awaken a person, then it becomes obligatory to do it. You can only warehouse a person and say, you're a dead loss, we can't do anything with you, if you do not believe that they can be, I'm going to use the word redeemed, but I don't necessarily mean it in a technical, religious sense. Do you got it?
I was
going
to say something like, you would have to believe that everything and everyone is one, that we're all connected, and even though we look different, we have our unity.
Yeah. I was kind of putting that under vision, but you could also put it under belief. If you don't have a vision of it, you can at least operate on it as a hypothesis or as a belief.
I was thinking maybe it's human needs theory that we can't be fulfilled by material.
Very, very important. That we can't, okay, the negative way of putting it is that we cannot be fulfilled by material possessions that we acquire, but the positive part is, if anything more important, that we can be fulfilled by things that are not scarce. So that another human set of human needs comes in, bonding, meaning, respect, and so forth. Very good. Others? What else? I'm not going to say, what else do you have to believe? Because you can practice nonviolence and not believe anything. But it will help. If the success of your nonviolence will lead to your believing certain things. Yeah?
Maybe that the current paradigm that we live in is just completely...
Whatever four-letter word we want to use, right? Yeah, it's a junk paradigm. There's no question about that. Usually, I mean, in the 70s, when we first started talking about this, we called it the prevailing paradigm, the dominant paradigm. It's totally non-sustainable based on falsehoods. Don't get us started because we'll lose our nonviolence thinking about it, but it's pretty much a disaster. I was asked to give a lecture to some Dutch business people last year about out-of-the-box thinking, and I started by describing the box, a little bit of the dominant paradigm is that the box has become a coffin. We really have to break out of it. Or another very good image is from Einstein. Human being is a part of the whole, called by us the universe, a part limited in time and space. This limitation is a kind of optical illusion which acts as a prison for us. So to break out of that prison of apparent separateness becomes the human goal. Very much a belief statement for nonviolence. Yeah, a couple of other things we can add to this. Troy?
I think to not have like a reductionist philosophy and then kind of how things are.
Right. Could you turn that into a positive statement? If we don't have a reductionist philosophy, what kind of philosophy would we have?
I guess maybe one that
kind of
reflects the idea of like tries to take in all consideration.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would say that the opposite of a reductionist view is, the term reductionism, which I use a lot, sort of has two components, I think. One is the belief that if you break things down to very small pieces, you will understand them. And that belief was kind of ended with quantum theory, because you got down to the smallest possible pieces, you realized you couldn't possibly understand it. So a non-reductionist view is an integrative view that tries to see things whole. But reductionism is also used to mean if you limit people to the lowest possible motive, if you're an advertiser, appeal to the lowest common denominator, so you get the most amount of people spending the most amount of money. That's reductionism. So in that sense, the opposite of reductionism would be what? It would be some exalted vision of what human beings are capable of. There's a, I see you, Ilana, I'll get to you in a second. There's a wonderful film that was made by the BBC, interestingly enough, Gandhi's enemies during the struggle, made a film called Gandhi's India, which describes the failure of the Nehru economic policies, which were the exact opposite of Gandhi's policies. You know, Gandhi wanted decentralization, village industry, simplicity, and all the rest of it. Nehru immediately went to 5-year central planning, kind of a blend, an unhappy blend of communism and capitalism. Anyway, in this film, there is a woman who's teaching in a Gandhian school. Her name is Asha Devi Aranyanayakam. In fact, that'll be on the final. I have to spell it correctly. I'm on. She was asked by the interviewer, well, don't you think that Gandhi was unrealistic, that he didn't really take into account the limits of human potential? And she just kind of exploded in this wreath of smiles and fingers dancing all over the place. And she said, there are no limits to human potential. But that tends to be a way that nonviolent folks look at the world, that what you see is not what you get. Yeah, what you see is not what you get. You can get a lot more than what you see. Okay, Ilana and then Alex.
I was just wondering if you could explicitly define what you mean when you say vision, frame, and beliefs, like the differences, because to me it sort of blends together the concepts.
I didn't quite get that. Try that again a little bit louder.
I mean, I get goals, but
okay.
Vision, frame, and beliefs to me, like, what I think they mean all sort of blends together.
Okay, the vision is the whole picture, the big picture, the enchilada. The frame is how are we going to construe a certain type of interaction given that big vision. So the frame is how shall we frame this conflict? Is it a fight to overcome the other person, or is it a conversation to awaken them and learn something in the process? Good example of framing. George Lakoff is very good at these things. Remind me. Okay. Taxes. Think about the term tax relief. Relief implies that paying taxes is a burden, and you could easily feel that way about it if you pay them. But suppose you think of taxes as dues that you pay to belong to an entity, a polity in this case. Then it's not a burden. So the words that you use are linked to metaphors which tend to put things in a frame. And those frames, you're right, they're a little bit like a vision, but they're a lot smaller. And your goals are, given this framework, what are you going to try to achieve? If you frame taxes as a burden, you're going to try to not pay them. If you frame them as dues, why, then you might end up being Swedish. They pay the most taxes in the world and have the highest human happiness indexes by any measures than anywhere. Okay, having mentioned speaking, I now turn to you.
I was just going to add to beliefs. I'm not sure that it's necessary, but I think something that helps is having like a belief in kind of a positive force in the world, whether it be
right.
Religion or just
yeah.
Community.
Let's just say a positive force in the world. Almost all nonviolent actors have said the universe bends toward justice, or they put it into some language that makes sense to them. And I would say it is, in fact, almost essential to believe that, because otherwise, what if you have renounced threat power, what other kind of power is going to be working for you? Yeah, John.
I believe that there's no irreducible conflict.
Yes. That's one of my favorites, that all conflicts are in the realm of perception. And therefore, awakening to a more accurate perception will make the conflict disappear. And the most poignant example of that we've used so far this semester is the conflict, which is sometimes called the clash of civilizations. Talk about a frame. Framing our desire for Iraqi oil as a struggle between good and evil. But anyway, Johann Dalton, after much investigation of what people on both sides of that divide really want, come up with the idea that what people in the West want is access to rapidly diminishing oil reserves, and what people in the Muslim world want is respect for their religion. So when you have understood that, and I suppose you could call this a kind of framing, when you've understood that, the conflict disappears. All you have to do is show them some respect, and the only thing that's preventing you from doing that is egotism. So when you have a president who says, I don't care what the facts are, I will never apologize for the American people, then you're not going to be able to get out of any conflict. Once you say, gee, we might have made a mistake, and gee, you probably have a point of view, can I hear from you what it is, then you will rapidly find that there's no such thing as, as I say, a conflict, which can, an irreducible conflict, ultimate conflict. There's differences, but none of them has to become a me versus you difference. Okay, well, that was the belief that I had in my mind. I guess we might add something which has already been implied, and that is that positive energy will have positive results. Negative energy will have negative results. This is part of Alex's belief that there's a positive force in the world. That's really about all I can think of as basic beliefs. Anyway, that's a lot. That would pretty much get you there. Okay, so my contribution to PAX 164A for fall 2007 now comes to an end. And it's your ball. What questions do you have? I know that there were some items on the ID list which we didn't quite get to or only glancingly referred to. So. Yes, go ahead.
Could you go over the third stage religion?
Okay. Yeah, the famous model of three stages of religion. Who wants to? Mostly you're going to chime in for fine-tuning. What is this model, and how does it help us here in PAX 164A? Just must have a little bar in your mind that says search. Let's put in three stages of religion and see what comes up. This is not to be confused with the devolutionary process that religions go through, where you have a revelation figure, followed by accommodation, and finally followed by co-optation. Time to start the cycle over again. This is a little different. This is an evolutionary view. If we were at Santa Cruz, which some of us may be in a couple of weeks on a surfboard, there would be a program there called History of Consciousness, and this is the kind of thing which I think they should be studying. We'll do what they're doing. But who wants to try? What are the three stages?
I actually know what the three stages are. I just don't really.
Do you know them when you're not looking at Pope's notebook?
I have them in my own notebook.
Okay, I'm just using it. Go ahead. I don't care where you're getting it.
Okay. Stage of revelation.
No, that's the other one. That's the devolutionary model. I'm sorry, they both have three steps. Once you get a PhD, you frame everything in three steps. So this is more like, in the evolution of human consciousness, what are three major stages in religion? Now, mind you, I'm not going to hold you to this in detail because it's my own theory, and I don't know if anybody else believes it.
I think we remember seeing God in the person, the individual.
That's the third stage.
Nature.
That's the first stage.
And the one in.
Anybody remember what the second stage is? In the community. Yeah, the stage or whatever. So you said see God in, and I suppose for a shorthand that will work, but I think it might be a little bit safer to say see the sacred or see power. So would you see practices designed to invoke and direct the power in. The first take on that is that the power of life is in the natural world. This is the pre-Woody Guthrie, sorry, pre-Woody Allen stage when you see your own life in nature, nature in your own life. That's where you go to, in, as I say, invoke and manage that power. Later on, the most powerful thing, which now becomes the framework for sanctions and norms of human behavior, is the community. So at this stage, if the community decides that an individual shall die, no one pipes up and says, hey, the community has no right to do that. So in effect, God is the community, if you will. And therefore, you know, Zeus of the Athenians is different from Zeus of the Thebans and so on. And this is a setup for really bad conflict. And the third stage is where you see the ultimate reality, the ultimate power is basically it's in consciousness. It's a form of consciousness. And you can most easily, most readily access that, get access to that consciousness through yourself, through your own human person. Therefore, the person becomes inviolable, and the state no longer has the right to take his or her life. And that's the negative part. The positive part is, when you want to look to regenerating society, you look to the individual, and a good example of that is Gandhi's world order model, which starts the individual serves the village, the family serves the village, village serves the district. You're starting with the power, potential of the person, and building up from there, rather than starting from some kind of big abstract structure and saying, what is the structure going to do to the individual?
What is the benefit of starting with the individual?
The benefit of starting with the individual, since you asked me, I will tell you, is that it's true. I think that ultimate power is within the individual, and person power is the underlying force in nonviolence. And when you have people power, we will be talking about this toward the beginning of next semester, people power is a summation of person power. If there's no person power there, the people power is very shallow. That is just the power of numbers. And you remember my famous quip, which I hope you remember everything I've ever said. A friend of mine had a demonstration when we were trying to sever the connection between the university and the nuclear weapons labs. A friend of mine said, if we had a million more people out here, we could stop this thing. I said, that's right, but if we had one person who was a million times more committed, we could also start. Now, I'm not saying what that one person would do. He or she may act alone, or he or she may, you know, assemble other people. So I think the benefit of that can be seen both negatively and positively. It's like we were saying, there's nothing wrong with strategic nonviolence. You can back into real nonviolence from a strategic nonviolence commitment by saying, okay, I'm not going to use violence. The next question that's going to come up is, what the heck am I going to use? That's when you go into principle. Similarly, if you say, hey, I'm not going to kill people because I don't have that right, you have to think of very different ways of normalizing behavior and so forth. So that's the negative part. The positive part is if you're going to start a movement and you go into this by saying, hey, I don't care what people believe, just get them out there. You know, here, hold this sign, never mind what it says. I mean, I had a friend who was living in Paris for a year, and he walked past a building, there was a big crowd, they were milling around, shouting stuff, and he couldn't quite follow what they were saying, and somebody in the crowd handed him a paper bag and said, jetla, jetla, which he knew enough to know that the guy was saying, throw, throw. So he threw it at the building, not knowing whether it was in the bag or what the building was, and of course it was a bomb, and it was some kind of embassy. So that, if you don't believe in that the individual's belief matters, you know, then you can use individuals. Remember what Kant said, that a human being is never a means to an end. Human beings. If you stop to think about it, we would all march up to the Haas building, Haas business. Boston School and shut down the Department of Human Resources. It was based on the false belief that human beings are resources for something else, whereas in reality, everything is a resource for the human individual.
So in like a central government, is that what the individuals just not and do whatever is told them by the government? Is what's happens when you start from the top down?
Yeah, and now there has to be some kind of collection of decision making. Every time you have a decision, you cannot have a plebiscite of 300 million people. It's too klutzy, it just doesn't work. So you invent something called representative government, which when you were using it, it worked fine. As somebody said recently, why put the Iraqis through the trouble of writing a constitution? Let's just give them ours, we're not using it. And that's one way. The other way is, and here's where Gandhi and Thoreau and the others weigh in. Okay, the individual's participation in the government, the system, the social order, social contract, is going to be only as far as it does not violate his or her conscience. In the system, there has to be included a mechanism for individuals who feel that their conscience has been violated to resist the system. If they don't do that, even if they're wrong, and they make a mistake and they think this is immoral and it's not immoral and they're wrong, it's their obligation to not let their conscience be violated. In the long run, that will add up to a much more stable order than an order in which people are A, coerced, or B, apathetic. Lana?
I understand that there is a concept that the individual can have. I can understand what you're saying, but then there's so many times when, you know, we talk about the Rosenstrasse
prison demonstration.
Yeah, other situations that like that when I don't understand how you really could achieve that same effect if it was just one person. I mean, they needed like the mass of all the women.
Yeah.
There
is no question that there are events where, because of the time factor, numbers do count.
Yeah.
We're not saying numbers don't count at all, but we are saying that numbers are secondary. And in the long run, if you need numbers, one really enlightened individual will collect those numbers. I like to think of that famous scene. Zapata, where Emiliano Zapata is being brought down to the Mexico City, tied to the back of a horse or something. And as he's walking along, a peasant comes out of the woods and joins him, and then another peasant. And finally, when you get to the city, the police turn around, and there's like 10,000 people behind him, and they realize they have to let him go. But he had to be that kind of person. See, I don't know if you've read this book, The Tipping Point. Malcolm Gladwell. It talks about Paul Revere, anyone who has survived an American public school education knows that when the British were attacking Boston Harbor, Paul Revere saw the signal and he jumped on his horse and he rode from house to house throughout these towns in Massachusetts, knocking on the door and saying, "The Redcoats are coming, the Redcoats are coming." Well, so that was the history that I learned and you've all learned, and as far as it goes, it's true. But it turns out that they actually sent out several individuals. And like another guy went south and Paul Revere went north, and this other guy, whose name I can't even remember, he would knock on the door and say, "The Redcoats are coming," and someone would look out and say, "Who's that?" "Nah, never heard of him." Close the window and go back to sleep. But when it's Paul Revere, "Oh my God, it's Paul Revere! Get your flintlock! Muster the troops! Mass the tropes," as a literary friend of mine says. So there are individuals who seem to have a key power to focus the energies of other individuals. And that's, so there's kind of an in-between between person power and people power. So to try to put together a big group without paying attention to who the people are, what they believe, how deep their commitment is going to lead to a very shallow, one-time-only episode. We'll be talking about that next semester too. It's sometimes called the effervescence of the crowd. The crowd gets very excited. But as you know from reading René Girard, or hearing me talk about René Girard, excited crowds, not always such a healthy thing. You know, just come out with one wrong word and suddenly they're excited about the wrong thing. Next thing you know, your effervescent crowd has turned into a lynch mob. So for all of these reasons, I think we have to start with a focus on awakening the individual. You see how carefully Gandhi did this in the famous episode on September 11th, 1906. I don't want you to take this oath unless you believe it in your heart, that you were not going to turn back no matter what. And if you don't believe that, then resist us. So these things can work together, and we're not denying that there are episodes where numbers are called for. But I think we have drastically underestimated the power of the individual. And I even believe that if one woman had marched into number 2 Rosenstrasse and said, I want my husband back, I'm not going, I don't care if you kill me, that it could have had a powerful effect, much more than we sometimes realize. In fact, there are some episodes like that in this book on Le Chambon. It's that village in southern France where they rescued so many refugees during the war. We're just one or two people standing up and saying, no, we won't go along with this. Change things around. Okay, time's getting a little short now. Sid, did you have something?
It was, I probably moved past it, but it was related to the stages of religion and then relating that to religion and society. Because I don't know, it seems that, like, I suppose we're a Christian country and I know there's religion and stuff, but that those ideas have been co-opted, like, an eye for an eye and stuff, to justify, like, the criminal justice system. And that seems like it's, like, a reversion to stage 2 almost of, like, community controlling the individual.
That's exactly what we're experiencing now. We're in a nominally stage 3 religion. We haven't really gotten there. And then it's a reversion to stage 2. But in fact, it's a little worse than if we were just plain old stage 2, because we're using the prestige of a fully developed, mystical, human-based religion to buttress a state-centric order. Yeah. And to Toynbee, the person who said he made it impossible for us to go on ruling India, but he made it possible for us to leave without rancor and without humiliation. He also wrote an article on falling back to the religion of the state because we have not grasped what the religion of the person is. Huh?
So the three stages are like kind of like evolving? Like
yes,
the second is like you only see the sanctity in community, right?
Not necessarily only. These can be cumulative. So you do see the power of life in nature, but you also see it, you sanctify this collective called the community, the state, the city, whatever it is. And yeah, to see that the ultimate power is within the human individual is to see that it's in other creatures and in the whole of nature. That's how that Einstein quote ends. We must break out of this prison and extend our sympathies to all humanity and the whole of nature in its beauty. Yeah. So they are developmental, and there's nothing wrong with being in stage 2 up to a point, but when you get to where stage 3 has been discovered and you're still clinging to stage 2, then it's a throwback and it can be less problems. And where it's a problem for us is that this is stage 2 is how scapegoat religions are organized. And unanimous violence and scapegoating are impossible if you believe in the sanctity of every individual. Because you don't go around looking for the guilty individual to scapegoat. Okay, Joanna, you had quite a few ideas for us.
About?
Okay, there were a couple of very sophisticated initials, acronyms that came up. They actually kind of go together, and I had planned to talk about this. The fact is, this is one of my favorite topics, and sometimes I go on and on about it, but we didn't get there. So So did anybody get there? Did you pick it out of my book or what?
Book. I know what it is.
Okay. Well, let's start us there.
Well, it's when two groups are in conflict and a third group is not involved with either side goes in between them.
Which one are you?
Oh, third party. No,
okay. Yeah.
That's right. Two resolve conflict. And give a few examples.
Yeah, third-party nonviolent intervention. You'll find, I think, an example in Peace Power magazine, which is the 10 cities in Richmond, where you have Crips and Bloods, and people have come in between and set up tents and living there 24/7, talking to the two people, and you know, reconciliation between enemies is possible, but it's often very, very difficult, and a third-party can do that. Now, in extremely large-scale, intense cases, where you actually have a war that's about to go on, and a third party gets in between and says, if you shoot, you'll hit us, then you can actually see an application of nonviolence to armed conflict, to war. So that's TPN, and we'll look at quite a few examples next semester. Catherine?
The CDD is civilian-based defense.
Yes.
Basically where the,
Yeah. So what is the difference really between civilian-based defense and third-party nonviolent intervention?
The civilians are doing it rather than like somebody outside of the two countries.
Yeah, third-party nonviolent intervention has a third party. And civilian-based defense is something you can do yourself. Both of these ideas grew out of Shanti Sena. Shanti Sena, you see, was the bold vision that you could use nonviolence at the biggest scale, at the most advanced forms of conflict, the latest stage forms of conflict. So in practice, what's grown up since the Shanti Sena model, which Gandhi partly developed, are these two forms. Really, they're not tremendously different, but there is a slightly different kind of intervention, quite a different dynamic.
Could you talk about the Shanti Sena then?
The Shanti Sena concept was probably in the back of Gandhi's mind for decades, but when he finally institutionalized it, the way he thought of it was groups of volunteers who could ideally be from the community that they were volunteering in, would live in the community, offer good offices or services of one kind or another, and especially when the need arose, be there to head off conflict. If you do this at an early enough stage, one of the classic forms of doing this is rumor abatement, because this is the way intercommunal conflict often flares out of control. One of my colleagues in Peace and Conflict Studies has written a book about conflict that killed quite a few people in northern India, and got started because a cow strayed into somebody's garden, and the next person said he sent that cow in there purposely, and then they said they're sending their cows in there, and the next thing you know, you have this upheaval. So if you have a Shanti Sena, for a Shanti Sena volunteer, he can go and investigate. He can ask, hey, are you guys sending these cows over? And they say, no, that cow is terrible. She always breaks out. And so then you go back and say, no, they're not killing people. So you can squash rumors and offer your services in various ways. But Gandhi said, if it's too late for all that, you're going to go out there and stand in between those two parties and say, I don't want you to do this. I am not on your side. I'm not on their side. I am on the side of peace, rising above the conflict. Now, Gandhi notionally applied the Shanti Sena to, or the idea of it anyway, to actual war fighting in the context of the impending, as it was thought to be, Japanese invasion, where you want men, women, and children go to the border, stand there, let them do their worst. Yes, yes, they may massacre us, but if they did, as he said, they would not be able to repeat the experiment. No one who did that would be able to do that again. Just your revulsion would rise up. This is one of our beliefs, right? That no human being is so utterly dehumanized that they can go on doing this forever. Yeah, question.
I had trouble over Thanksgiving trying to explain that to my dad.
Okay.
And he said that he kept saying, well, how do you know that someone would be so repulsed? Like, what about, mm-hmm. I mean, he was saying, you know, in World War II, when their goal was to get rid of all these people, if they had stood up and said no, they would have just plowed through them and been happy. And I found it hard to come back with a response.
Yeah, the only way to take care of your dad on that question, and it comes up a lot, is through actual historical cases. There really are no cases on record. I think this is probably going to be true, of people who stood up nonviolently and said, go ahead and kill us if you must, but we're not backing down, and who actually simply were slaughtered, and then the group just went on to slaughter the next group and the next group. What people who say that happened, is what they're confused about is there have been many cases of people who were massacred, but they were massacred unwillingly. That's very different. If they were helpless and they were killed, that doesn't have the same dynamic. So it doesn't have that transformation of the human will. I mean, even if there were a case or two, I think you could. There are so many cases on record of individuals who were about as dehumanized as they could get, and yet something reached them. That I think we are justified in going on the belief that it would always awaken people. Now, mind you, that's not quite the same as saying it would always work. Hey, it might be too late, but hey, does violence always work? Certainly it's not. So that's the way that we're approaching it. We're saying that it's infallible on the level of psychic forces, not necessarily infallible on the level of the social enactment of those forces, but certainly much more reliable than going the other way. One of my favorite awakening stories is in my book, and I may actually have told it to you about friends of mine who were working in the Polish underground. They were Jews living in Warsaw. I'll tell you this story. Yeah, the Gestapo caught them in a raid, and they were about to take them away. They had a 2.5-year-old boy, and he didn't know what was going on, and he saw these shiny buttons on his Gestapo captain's uniform, and before anyone knew what he was doing, he was playing with these buttons. And the parents were absolutely frozen with horror, and the captain looked down, and he saw what was going on, and he looked up, and he said, I have a little boy at home just his age, and I miss him very much. And then he ordered his men out of the apartment. He said, your son has saved your life. So if that can happen to a Gestapo captain in the act of raiding Jewish underground workers, I really cannot believe that there is any category of people so depraved that this would not work. There may be some individuals who are so far gone we're not going to be able to reach them in this life. So then the nonviolent attitude is, how did they get that way? Let's find out which television programs they were watching. Yeah, Robin.
Can you reconcile the idea of heart unity with the fact that there are people like that on the planet that have foregone?
Well, I guess I am going to hold out for the belief that if you had world enough in time, to quote, I guess that's Shakespeare. No, it's Marlowe. If we had world enough in time, you could reach anybody. But when I say that maybe some people who we cannot reach in their lifetime and ours with the tools that we've got to do something else to protect ourselves and keep them from deepening their own criminality. it's a question of time, not a question of inherent possibility. Given enough time. Gandhi had this belief anyway. He was once asked, would you be willing to live with the devil? And he said, oh yeah, I'd be willing to. I'm not sure he would like it, though. And the person said, why not? And Gandhi said, he'd be forced to change. So again, in 164a, we want to talk about the ideal. In 164b, we're going to have to talk about how to articulate this ideal reality with the real world that we live in. No question about it. So that's what I would say about that. Given enough time and given a nonviolent enough person, we could reach any goal. But given the real world, there may be some cases which are too hard for that. But obviously, what we should then try to do is so organize our culture so that there are fewer and fewer of those.
I was just thinking, I read this article this morning about San Francisco Police Department and how they're using these guns that have shoot like beanbags. And so they stun people and probably knock them over and bruise them, but don't actually kill them. Mm-hmm. They've been using them a lot on like mentally disabled people.
Oh my god.
To like subdue them, or if people are like, they gave a couple examples where this.
Yeah.
Like a woman who was in the, like trying to commit suicide and had a knife and was flinched
over,
and they shot her, and so they took the knife away to the hospital.
Yeah.
And like, and I wasn't sure what to think of it, like if it's just replacing one weapon with another and it's just perpetrating the same system, or if it's like maybe sort of.
Yes, that is a very interesting question for us. Beanbag guns and tasers and things like that. And you have to subdue people by force, is it worth it to try and do it in such a way that you don't kill them in the process? It raises a difficult problem for us because there is this principle that sometimes the good is the enemy of the best. I've noticed, for example, that if you look at future projections of what war will be like Star Wars, things like that, what they have done is reduced war to a level where it's still fightable. If everybody were armed with shoulder-mounted atomic bombs, war would be impossible. The first volley, everybody would be dead. So they're saying in the distant future, they'll have these medieval swords, except they'll be electronic. Chang, chang! But I actually think that that's a bad thing to do, to create what they still call tactical nuclear weapons, which are usable, is not a step toward peace. However, there is the other side of it. If a woman is about to commit suicide, you've got to use what you've got. And it's much better to have, you'll get more with a beanbag gun and a 38 than with a 38 alone. However, just one second, I think that really the way for us to approach it is why did we let things get like this? Why do we have 1,000 people jumping off the Golden Gate Bridge? Prevention is where we want to start working. And we want to start working from the positive, from the nice, here borrowing Joy's idea, non-reductionist view of the world, where people have a sense of purpose and at least a glimmer of a hope that they can fulfill that purpose, at least in part. All this stuff which we have. That's why I argue very strongly in Search for a Nonviolent Future that nonviolence actually is that purpose that we're looking for.
I was just going to say there's also another article about how there was a guy who had like a seizure, kind of like a mental breakdown in the theater, and cops went in, and instead of subduing him calmly, they shot off like 20 rounds, killed him, and shot another police officer. So it was there's these two articles. I was like, maybe we need to get rid of this.
We need to get rid of the whole thing. There really is no way to have a clean police force, which, even British police, who for so many years did not carry weapons, eventually it just is going to degenerate, unless you're working on the nonviolent restoration of society from the positive side. Eventually their force will be overtaxed. I mean, look at this horrible thing in New York, where somebody was coming out, of course, he shouldn't have been in a strip club. I know. But he had just gotten married, and he had a bachelor's at a bachelor party, and he came out of the this club, and for some reason the police thought that he was threatening them, and this plainclothes policeman fired 50 rounds into the car and killed him and wounded two other people. It's not a very good record with 50 rounds. Kill one person. That's not our point. Our point is, it's, you know, it's like what Norman Cousins said. Remember, there was this famous revelation that the U.S. Navy have steamed around in San Francisco Bay spraying bacterial agents into the fog to see what would happen. And what happened? The guy got sick and he died. And he was an elderly person. His grandchildren found out about this and they sued the Navy. And you're like, are we saying that this is a good thing for the Navy to do? No. But what we're saying is, once you decide that you cannot defend yourself and you need an elite, and that elite has to be heavily armed so that they overwhelm the opposition, they are going to do things like this. And there's no such thing as a clean, violent defense. Great. Okay, Joy?
I guess I was just going to elaborate on that. It's not that profound. But the police, the San Francisco police, have actually killed a lot of people.
Yeah. Well,
so I guess training would be a better option.
Training would be a better option. It would help. But still, what we should never, let's get back to the vision page. We should never renounce the ultimate goal of being able to live in a society where there is no violence at all. That has to be our ideal. We're not putting a timeline on it, but that's the ideal. And it, once we lose sight of that ideal, then we're just tampering with various degrees of trying to keep violence contained. And there's even an argument that that human rights is a bad model, because it just says you can't go beyond a certain point in abusing people. That even being in serving in the ambulance corps, which our hero did several times, is not a good idea, because you're sanitizing war, and it's almost better to let it out there, let it be as violent as it can be, let people see this, let them get disgusted. Admittedly, it takes a lot for people to get disgusted in that, where they'll do something like that. And anyway, that's how the arguments go. Okay. Any other IDs, Joanna, that we didn't cover? Okay. Everybody's perfectly good about that? Divya?
I had one about the stomach stretches and stuff.
Okay. Sitting next to you knows a great deal about that, actually. this is the theory of the three gunas. Does anyone want to run through it very quickly and tell us how it becomes pertinent to nonviolence? What is the theory, first of all? What are gunas, anyhow? Amy?
The gunas are three states of energy.
Yeah.
And the first one, tamas, is inertia, and it's kind of the equivalent of cowardice.
Uh-huh.
And then the second one, rajas.
Rajas. It's not Spanish.
It's like kind of like unfocused, like chaotic activity.
Uh-huh.
And then which is associated with like greed, which is kind of indirect violence, and just outright like violence.
Mm-hmm.
And then sattva is associated with harmony.
Yeah, that's a perfect answer. The theory of the model is that all of phenomenal reality can be analyzed as an interplay of these three basic energy states. Second proposition is that it's extremely evolutionary, developmental, and that in human experience, well, if you look at evolution, actually, what were we before we became creatures? We were rocks, right? That's very tamasic. Yeah, we have these rocks that we found in a little trench that we were digging in our property. They have fossils in them. So we went to the local geologist and asked him how old those things are. See, he said 300 million years. So that's real inertia. And then we got to, you know, moving creatures. And then finally, we, at least so far, the final stage has been, a Berkeley professor. Homo sapiens sapiens sapiens, where you can not only overcome Stanford in a football game, but you can think, make moral choices, things like that. So this is evolutionary on the long scale, and it's also evolutionary on the individual scale in the sense that we have pockets of Thomas inside of us. And the way to deal with them is to turn them into rajas. And the way to deal with rajas is to guide it with sattva. And you started to sketch in the tie-ins with violence. That's basically correct. Remember Gandhi saying, I can make a satyagrahi out of a violent person. I cannot make a satyagrahi out of a coward. Because you cannot leapfrog from tamas to sattva. You've got to pass through rajas, at least, provisionally. So in many ways, you will find that this is kind of a useful model.
There
is?
Okay, just one of the terms, Job, the text, I don't remember what was
said. Yeah. Okay, does anybody remember why the book of Job, how the book of Job plays in?
Does it have something to do with scapegoating?
Definitely.
Job's friends were saying that he deserved what he was getting because he did something to make God mad. Is that on the right track?
Yes, you're on the right track. Want to go a little further?
Well, the story goes that that Job was a God-fearing man and lost all of his possessions and his children and became sick with
whatever. He was totally wiped out.
Yeah. And his friend said that he needed to reconcile. He must have done something to make God mad and make all this stuff happen to him.
Uh-huh.
Otherwise, it wouldn't have happened. And he kept saying,
and
I didn't do
anything. What was Job's response to that?
I think he said that he didn't do anything.
Right.
And he kept on doing,
there was nothing for him to do.
Yeah, he just
but
accepted it.
He said to the comforters that I'm innocent. You can persecute me all you want, but I am innocent.
Yeah.
And why is that significant for us? Think of Rene Girard's own model. Yeah.
When you're scapegoating, it can only work if you are convinced that the person is guilty or believes themselves to be the cause of the problem.
Right. If the scapegoat image will, of course, not work if the victim wasn't guilty. And so the entire scapegoating institution, which is still with us in many ways, is predicated on the belief, which you can manufacture, on your being able to manufacture the belief that the victim was guilty. That's what Girard talks about, they're supposed to be chronicles, 12th century chronicles. There's this French town, village, there's a plague. They discovered it was the Jews. The Jews are poisoning the well. They expel the Jews, the plague. So this text, which we take as history, has the same structure and has the same veracity, namely none, as all of these ancient myths and all of these ritual practices that are used in this way and so forth. So, his point is that the minute you hold a microphone up to the victim and the victim can say, I didn't do it, which is what Lee Harvey Oswald said just before they killed him, and he was interviewed on television and said, I didn't do it. You may have lots of problems with me, I'm not saying I'm perfect, but I did not shoot the president. And so they killed him within a couple of hours because that would have scotched the whole thing. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have used that example. This is terrible. Forget I ever said that. But what Girard says is Job breaks the model. Once you have a victim who is interviewed on Nightline and says, I am not guilty, I didn't commit the crime, the whole system breaks apart. So whom does Girard propose as the opposite of Job, a perfect victim, like a victim to die for? You pay millions of dollars to have a victim like this. Remember?
Oedipus, right. Oedipus, Oedipus of Sophocles' famous play, Oedipus the King. Because he not only discovers his own guilt, so you don't even have to pay to find out who did it. Most importantly, he punishes himself. Remember, because we have all of those rituals in which the person who kills the guilty person is also guilty, and then he can go on and on from there, like a domino effect. So the perfect victim is one who says, I did it, I would love to get victimized, please kill me, and the buck stops here. So that, and it is not pretending to be a historical episode. It's a play. Okay, so scapegoating is a tremendously, what word am I here? Common, overused format for some violence, and especially violence of the social group. Anything that will help us break out of that. And notice, Job speaks as an individual. It's not like a jury of his peers finds him innocent. The individual speaks out, breaks the mold. Girard's point is that it's only in the Judeo-Christian religion that you renounce into a non-scapegoating. Your God is not a God of violence. God is the God of the victim, for the first time. I think he's wrong about that, but this because he doesn't know anything about any other religions. But there's no question that scapegoating is very stage two, very violent. We have to break out. Okay, well, I guess you all get to now pick up a copy of this gorgeous